And now finally, let's see what happens if black responds with b6. Not c5, not d5, but b6. Of course, in some cases, it will transpose to similar positions as we already seen. White continues with e3 anyway, bishop b7, and here I recommend to play h3, making sure black will not get to play knight h5 and trade the knight for the bishop. Now, of course, the whole idea is after moves like knight h5, we can retreat simply the bishop here, and then the knight will find itself in an awkward position on h5. So bishop e7, bishop d3, castle, castle, and c5, and c3. And now black can play various things. There is one, for example, a couple of years ago, Gata Kamsky won a nice game after cd4. So now white has two options. White can take back with the e-pawn, which is not bad, but Gata prefers taking back with a c-pawn. And let's see how he developed this game. Knight c6, a3, very typical move, preventive move, avoiding the black knight coming to b4 and chasing the white bishop from its ideal position on d3. Black played a6 and came knight bd2. As you can see, white has pleasant position, a little bit more active, a little bit more space. Black played d5. This I would consider as good news, even though black wanted to prevent white from expanding perhaps further with e3, e4. But now the bishop on b7 became kind of very restricted, and clearly the white bishop on d3 is much more active than the one on b7. White continued with rook c1, very natural move, putting the rook on the open file. And for example, now it's an interesting point. If black plays the natural rook c8, then white plays queen e2, attacking the pawn here on a6. And if now black plays b5, then the c5 square becomes weak, and white can jump right to b3 and get there. Very nice position for white. So after rook c1 in that particular game, black played h6. White could play queen e2 solidly, not bad, but Gata played knight e5, knight takes e5, and now white has two pleasant choices, taking with bishop or pawn. He chose pawn takes in this game. Knight e4, very important point. Regrouping the knight to d4. That's a beautiful outpost for the white knight, making sure that the bishop on b7 will not be revived by the black pawn advancing to d4 sometime in the future. b5, knight d4. Gorgeous for white. Queen b6. And now, time to attack. It's a free attack without black having any counterplay. Queen g4. Obviously, the threat is to capture the pawn on h6. Black moves out of the pin, and now time to chase the knight away, so the other bishop also gets revived. Knight c5. Now white has actually a pretty combination that works right away with rook takes, and if bishop takes, then bishop h6. Pretty impressive. Going immediately after the black king, and after f5, check, knight takes, check, king h1, and basically it's pretty much game over. Instead, Gata played bishop b1, which is still a good move, still keeps white's winning position. The knight retreated, he just played a safe way, there was no reason really to sacrifice and need to worry if he miscalculates something, so he certainly did the practically better choice. King g8, and now just crush black's king side. The game continued with takes, takes, f5, knight e6, and Black had enough and resigned. If in this position, after bishop takes h6, Black wouldn't take the bishop right away, but would try to play f5. Of course, White is already a pawn up, could just retreat the bishop and win simply, but that is actually a brilliant move that is more powerful, that is rook c7. And if queen takes, bishop takes, and of course if king takes, fork, and Black is lost. Pretty impressive game, considering especially that it starts out from a relatively solid opening, such as the London system. Let's go back again to this position, and there are, of course, a number of other games with knight c6, knight d2. And now there are, let's look at some games when Black actually transposed back to this d5 line, queen e2. And now I'd like to show you another game of Gatakamski that he played also in 2016 against Castellanos Rodriguez in France. And that game continued with h6, rook a d1, and bishop d6. So this is quite interesting because if you compare this to the previous chapter, when we were looking at similar type of positions, it's almost the same, except Black now lost the tempo because played bishop e7 to d6. The bishop got to d6 in two moves. The extra move that White has is this little h3 move. So here Kamsky continued with bishop takes d6, queen takes, and e4. The idea is that if Black takes, White takes, 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 again, checkmate threat. And now if g6, queen e3, gaining an important tempo, king g7, and bishop e4, again with a very pleasant position for White. Not a major advantage, but a very pleasant position and uncomfortable for Black. Going back to the position after e4, in Kamsky's game, Black responded with queen e7, and now, again, we have a French defense type of position with the situation that the dark squared bishops were already exchanged, which certainly doesn't hurt White. Black is stuck with the bad bishop that's very restricted behind his pawns. Continued with knight e7. Queen e3. I'll just quickly show you the whole game so you understand the game plans. Slowly, slowly, White makes a lot of preventive moves. And now regroups the knight so the white pawns can move forward. Very important that since the center is closed, even though White's king is on the king's side, it's okay to advance the pawns. Black has no real entry point along the c-file. White has nicely covered those squares. Black is trying, but not really creating any serious threats. Of course, feel free to go through these games later, again, through the PGN file, at your leisure. Now you can feel the strengths of the attack. And now Black kind of lost it. The only chance was to trade on f5, but Black played knight f8, being scared of threats. And now came f6, very powerful move. And now all White needs to do is get the queen to h6 to checkmate. So the knight retreats, protecting the rook on d2 and opening that diagonal for the queen to appear on. And Black resigned. Okay, let's move back again to the position that we had here. Move 8, Black played knight c6. White plays knight d2, Black d5, queen e2. And now there was a famous game also this year in 2016. A world champion Magnus Carlsen against one of the top players in the world, Grandmaster Tomaszewski from Russia, and he played bishop d6. And the world champion here continued with rook fe1, a different approach than what Katakamski took. And that's another thing you can notice in this opening, that there are multiple plans, multiple ways to play, and you can kind of try different ones, because none of them win, but all of them put different challenges to the opponent. So here, black played knight e7, came rook d1. White is just centralizing the rooks, getting ready for the fight. Knight g6, and he took. And came bishop d6, bishop d6, and knight e5. We can see the eternal pattern that the black bishop on b7 is suffering with no potential whatsoever. And now black played a suspicious move, g5, came f4, g takes f4, and now a surprising move, rook f1, but a strong one at that. Now it looks very scary for black to take and allow rook takes f6. And for example, if takes, white wins after bringing the rook to the attack. And then if pawn takes, just rook f4, and then queen check and rook checkmate. Perhaps black overlooked this hidden move, this rook f1 move. Now came knight d7. And white continued the attack with queen h5. Again, if pawn takes, here the problem is knight f7 simply, and then checkmate in the corner on h8. So black played knight f6, queen h4. You're already getting used to it that taking on e3 is not good for one reason or another. Here again it would be rook taking. And for example, if takes, white could just take back simply, and again taking here is deadly after rook d3 and rook g3 checkmate. So here black continued with queen d8 and rook took on f4. And now black made, I think, a losing move by knight e4. Of course, it looked already extremely dangerous, but after this knight e4, white simply transposes to a winning endgame. And that's something you need to remember, that just because you're attacking and the opponent is able to defend against the attack, very often you need to transform one type of advantage, like an attack, to an endgame advantage or material advantage. And that's what we're seeing here. Queen took on h4, rook takes, pawn takes. So far we have equal material, not for too long. Pawn takes. Now you can see how the black pawn structure is kind of falling apart. Double pawns, isolated pawns, and white gets to the 7th rank. Rook b8, b3, making sure the white pawn will not be in danger on b2. Black played a5, rook c7. Black cannot hang on to the pawn on c5 because both black rooks are busy defending the bishop and the pawn on f7, respectively. Came a4, b takes, and the a pawn is running. Rook b7, rook c5, now white is already up two pawns. And after rook a7, rook c4, Tomaszewski admitted that the world champion can handle from here on, being two pawns down, resigned. Well, that's about it for this chapter.